Hello everyone, now let us discuss about part 4 of antiangional drugs. And in the current session, we will be focusing on the other antiangional drugs and drug combinations in the angina therapy. Now coming to the first drug, it is dipyridamol. It acts as a coronary vasodilator. It is a powerful coronary vasodilator and it has antiplatelet inhibitor. The mechanism of action is it leads to vasodilation by preventing the uptake and degradation of adenosine, which is a local mediator involved in the autoregulation of coronary flow in response to ischemia. And it increases the coronary blood flow by dilating resistance vessel and abolishing the autoregulation. One more important point is with dipyridamol, cardiac work is not decreased because the venous return is not reduced. Hence, it does not relieve anginal symptoms or avert the ECG changes. The other mechanism is it increases the cyclic AMP levels in the vascular smooth muscle and leads to dilation of resistance vessel. One more important point is the pharmacological success but therapeutic failure of dipyridamol is due to the coronary steel phenomena. By dilating the resistance vessel in non-ischemic zone as well, it diverts the blood flow away from the ischemic zone. As a result, the blood flow in the ischemic area is reduced, which is not therapeutically required. Here you can see this is the conducting vessel and it is atheroma. By taking dipyridamol, it leads to dilation, ischemic dilation of resistance vessels is seen. This is the normal conducting vessel. Here, dilation is seen. Because of dilation, the flow increases in the ischemic zone. And these are the resistance vessel in the non-ischemic zone. By taking dipyridamol, the dilation in non-ischemic zone also occurs. As a result, the blood flow in the ischemic area is reduced, which is not therapeutically desired. This is a phenomenon called as vascular steel. Coming to the mechanism of action, as we have discussed, it has antiplatelet action. So, performs its antiplatelet action by two scenarios. The first one is inhibition of phosphodiesterase type 3 enzyme. It prevents the breakdown of cyclic AMP, increases the cytoplasmic cyclic AMP, which lowers the intracellular calcium levels inside the platelets. And thus, it inhibits the platelet aggregation. One more important point is the elevation of intracellular calcium is a major driving force to cause conformational changes and degranulation of platelets, which results in the platelet aggregation. And similarly, by inhibiting adenosine uptake by RCB and vascular cells, it increases the adenosine levels. And this adenosine binds to A2 subtype of the platelet, causing rise in the intracellular cyclic AMP. And because of its antiplatelet action, dipyridamol, it is not majorly used as antianginal drugs, but it is employed as adjuvant antiplatelet drug. So this is the overall mechanism of dipyridamol. It inhibits the phosphodiesterase enzyme, thereby increasing the cyclic AMP, which leads to platelet aggregation. It is mainly governed by mediated PGI2. Coming to the uses, dipyridamol, it is combined with aspirin to prevent the clot formation and it is ineffective as single drug or it is ineffective in monotherapy. Along with coumarin, it prevents the post-op thromboembolic complications of the cardiac valve replacement. Coming to the next drug, it is trimethoxazine. It has no effect on the heart rate and blood pressure, both at rest and during exercise. But angina frequency is reduced and exercise capacity is increased by taking trimethoxazine. Coming to the mechanism of action, it is a myocardial metabolism modulator and it is termed as PFOX, which is nothing but fatty acid oxidation pathway inhibitor. It inhibits the oxidation of fatty acids. By inhibiting the mitochondrial long chain 3-ketoacyl-CoA thiolase enzyme, LC3-KAT, which is a key enzyme in the fatty acid oxidation, it reduces the fatty acid oxidation and promotes the glucose oxidation in myocardium. And generally in ischemic cell, the energy obtained during glucose oxidation requires less oxygen than the fatty acid oxidation. Oxidation of fatty acid requires more oxygen, whereas oxidation of glucose requires less oxygen. So, by promoting the glucose oxidation in the myocardium, this drug, it reduces the oxygen demand in the ischemic area and it maintains proper energy metabolism during ischemia. It also decreases the intracellular ATP levels. Coming to the pharmacokinetics of trimethoxazine, it has good oral absorption and it is partly metabolized and largely excreted unchanged in urine. The T-half is 6 hours. The side effects are gastric burning, dizziness, fatigue, muscle cramps and reverse Parkinson's is seen in elderly. Coming to the uses, it is used as add-on therapy for angina and post-myocardial infarction. It further reduces the anginal attacks and increases the exercise duration for patients who are taking long-acting nitrates and beta blockers. Some of the marketed formulations are Flavidone, Carvedone, Trivedone, which are available in 20 mg tablets and 35 mg modified release tablets. Coming to the next drug, it is Ranolazine. The mechanism of action is it inhibits the late sodium current in the myocardium, which indirectly facilitates calcium entry through sodium and calcium exchanger. Ranolazine, it indirectly facilitates the calcium entry through sodium and calcium exchanger. So this leads to reduction in the calcium overload in myocardium, thereby decreasing the contractility. It has a cardioprotective effect. It reduces the tension in the wall, leading to decreased oxygen requirement. And additionally, it has also found to inhibit the long chain fatty acid, LC3-KAT enzyme, which is involved in the oxidation of fatty acids. And as such, it does not have any effect on the heart rate and blood pressure. Coming to the uses, it is used as monotherapy and added to conventional therapy as its efficacy in decreasing the frequency of anginal attacks and prolonging exercise duration. It is used as an adjuvant in the conventional therapy because of its efficacy to reduce the frequency of attacks and to prolong the exercise tolerance or duration. So this is the overall mechanism of action. Generally in ischemia, the late inward sodium current increases and this ranolazine, it inhibits the late sodium current. Thereby calcium overload is reduced and mechanical dysfunction and electrical instability are prevented, which leads to cellular injury and death by inhibiting this step. And by taking ranolazine, incidence of atrial flutter also decrease. But it has a side effect that it prolongs the QT interval and hence it is not given with other QT prolongative drugs. Coming to the pharmacokinetics, it has good oral absorption is slow. It takes 4 to 6 hours. Bioavailability is 30 to 50% and T-half is 7 hours. And it is metabolized by CYP3A4 isoenzyme and it is excreted in urine. Coming to side effects, they are dizziness, weakness, constipation, postural hypotension, headache, dyspepsia. and should not be given for patients who are taking CYP3A4 inhibitors, but it can be given to patients who are taking sildenafil. Coming to the marketed formulation, they are Ranozen, Ranax, Carpinex, Redulent, Ranolaz, etc., all available in 0.5 grams sustained release tablets. Coming to the next drug, it is Ivabradine. It is a pure bradycardiac drug or heart rate lowering anti-anginal drug, and it is used as an alternative to beta blockers. Coming to the mechanism of action, it leads to blockage of cardiac pacemaker cell F channels, which are termed as funny cation channels that open during the early part of slow diastole, that is during the phase 4 depolarization. And these F channels are expressed primarily in sinoatrial cells and to some extent in retinal cells. The inward current resulting by the opening of F channels determines the slope of phase 4 depolarization. And the selective blockade of this inward current by Ivabradine results in heart rate reduction, decreased cardiac oxygen demand, and prolongation of diastole, which tends to increase the myocardial perfusion, that is nothing but oxygen supply. So on a whole, Ivabradine, it inhibits the inward current from F channels, which determines the slope of phase 4 depolarization. So this is the schematic representation. Here you can see, because of increased cyclic AMP, increased contractility and increased heart rate is seen. Inward current from the F channels leads to increased heart rate. And this Ivabradine, it blocks the inward current through these funny cation channels, and thereby it reduces the heart rate. Coming to the side effects, the main side effects are excessive bradycardia and visual disturbance. Other than that, extrasystoles, prolongation of PR interval, headache, dizziness and nausea are also seen. And it should not be given if the heart rate is less than 60 beats per minute and in case of sick sinus and atrial fibrillation. It is also contraindicated with CYP3A4 inhibitors and drugs which prolong the QT interval. Coming to the pharmacokinetics, it is well absorbed orally, bioavailability is 40%, T-half is 2 hours, and it is metabolized by CYP3A4. Coming to the uses, Ivabradine, it is used in chronic stable angina to improve the exercise tolerance and to reduce the angina frequency. And it is employed or used in inappropriate sinus tachycardia in patients who are intolerant to beta blockers or if the beta blockers are contraindicated. In both the cases, Ivabradine is used to treat inappropriate sinus tachycardia. And it is also used in stable grade 2 and grade 4 heart failure due to systolic dysfunction in patients with sinus rhythm greater than 70 beats per minute. So these are some of the clinical uses of Ivabradine. Coming to the marketed formulations, they are Ivabrad, Bradia, Ivabeat, which are available in 5 and 7.5 mg tablets. Now, coming to the next topic, that is drug combinations in the angina. The principal objective of anti-anginal therapy is to abort or terminate the anginal attacks when they occur and to provide the symptomatic relief in addition to modifying the course of coronary artery disease, simultaneously providing cardioprotection with antiplatelet drugs, statins and ACE inhibitors. So this is the principal objective of anti-angina therapy. Coming to the selection of anti-anginal drugs. The selection of a particular drug, it depends on the stage and severity of the disease, associated cardiac and other medical conditions, and the individual acceptance of the side effects. And in general, short-acting nitrates are used for chronic prophylaxis of angina. especially to abort and to terminate the anginal attacks. The drug of choice to abort and to terminate the anginal attacks is short-acting nitrates. The anti-anginal efficacy and the tolerability of long-acting nitrates, including the transdermal glycerol trinitrate, beta blockers, and long-acting calcium channel blockers are similar. But the beta blockers, they achieve greater reduction in the number of anginal attacks than the calcium channel blockers, and additionally, they provide survival benefit. Whenever monotherapy is unable to provide relief in tolerated doses, combinations of anti-anginal drugs are used. Now, coming to the combinations. The first one is beta blocker is taken along with long-acting nitrate. It is used especially in classic angina. Because the tachycardia due to nitrate is blocked by beta blocker, and the beta blocker which causes ventricular dilation, it is counteracted by the nitrate, and the tendency of beta blocker to reduce total coronary flow is opposed by the nitrates. Hence, they are given in combination to counteract the side effects of each other and to improve the efficacy, overall efficacy of the therapy. The second combination is beta blocker with slow-acting dihydropyridine. This is similar to that of beta blocker combination with long-acting nitrate, and it is also used to treat classic angina. The element of coronary vasospasm in the classic angina. Whenever element of coronary vasospasm exists in the classical angina, in such cases, combination of beta blocker and slow-acting dihydropyridines are used. But verapamil and diltiazem should not be used with beta blockers since their depressant effect on the sinae and atrial node may add up. Beta blocker can be used in combination with long-acting nitrate and short-acting dihydropyridine. But the beta blocker should not be used with calcium channel blockers like verapamil and diltiazem because of their depressant effect on SA node and AV node. Coming to the next combination, nitrates and calcium channel blockers. The nitrates, they decrease the preload, and the calcium channel blockers, they decrease the afterload on the coronary flow. Thereby, they decrease the workload and improve the coronary perfusion. And the combination of nitrates and calcium channel blockers is used in severe vasospastic angina whenever the beta blocker is contraindicated. And it is also, the next one is severe and resistant cases of classical angina. In case of severe and resistant cases of classical angina, combination of all three classes are indicated. Because nitrates, they primarily decrease the preload, calcium channel blockers may reduce the afterload and increase the coronary flow, and beta blockers, they decrease the cardiac work primarily by direct action on the heart. And whenever all three drugs are used, all three classes of drugs are used, verapamil and diltiazem should be avoided in such combinations. Here you can see, to treat the severe and resistant classical cases of classic angina, all three classes of drugs are used. The nitrates are used to reduce the preload, calcium channel blockers are used to reduce the afterload and to increase the coronary flow, and beta blockers are used to decrease the cardiac work. And whenever calcium channel blockers are used, verapamil and diltiazem are contraindicated in such combinations. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe for further videos on pharmacology and other related pharmaceutical sciences.